All right, so in this one, we're going to be looking at storage devices. So what are they? They're referred to as digital storage, storage medium, storage media. They are secondary storage devices. That's what we're going to be focusing on. Now, there is primary and there is secondary. We're not going to be looking at primary now. We're only going to be looking at secondary. And secondary is what we actually use to store our files, folders, pictures, images, videos, so on and so forth, okay? That is secondary storage. The first one we're going to look at is probably the one that most of you guys know about. So this is the older technology. It's called a hard disk drive or a hard drive, right? Now, I'm going to quickly go over some of the characteristics and try explain why they are the way they are. So because it's older technology, it's actually cheaper than, let's say, an SSD is the alternative to hard drives in most cases. It's cheaper per gigabyte. It's not just cheaper, right? I can actually buy a 1 terabyte SSD and a 1 terabyte hard drive. But if you look at the prices, there is a big difference for the same 1 terabyte. And that's simply because hard drives are cheaper per gigabyte. So again, if I want to buy a 1,000 gigabyte hard drive or a 1,000 gigabyte SSD, in every single case, the SSD is going to be more expensive for the same amount of storage, okay? Next, we're going to be looking at, it's reliable. It lasts for a very, very, very long time. Some of you guys who have consoles like the PS4, the Xbox One or the Xbox 360, those have traditional hard drives. So this older technology here, hard drives. And those things, they work for a decade or more, okay? Whereas, conversely, the SSDs don't work as long. I will go over those qualities as well or characteristics as well, but it's good to compare and contrast. So they are slower than SSDs. And one of the things that makes them slow is that they have this disk. So inside of every hard drive, there's going to be this actual circular section. This is an actual disk. This is called the seek head. You don't need to know this much detail, but you might as well know it anyway. And the disk will be spinning. The seek head will go left to right and read the sections of the disk that need to be read. Whereas an SSD, it does not have any of this. No moving parts, no spinning disk, no seek head. It's simply memory chips stacked on top of each other, okay? External hard drives are not as portable as some other options. That is very true. These are quite bulky in some cases and quite heavy. The newer hard drives that we have nowadays, relatively small, but still a lot heavier than, let's say, something like a memory stick or a USB that can fit in your pocket, right? These are a bit larger. So those are some of the characteristics of a hard disk drive. The next thing we have are SSDs, and this abbreviation means solid state drives. They're essentially flash storage device, flash memory stacked on top of each other to try and make a storage device. Okay, so if you look here on my screen, these chips here, they're put together to create as much flash storage as you need. So characteristics and limitations of SSDs: very low power consumption, newer technology, no moving parts compared to a hard disk drive, so it needs a lot less power to actually read and write, so access the information and write or put information on the drive. It only has a finite number of read and write cycles, meaning after a certain amount of time of using an SSD every day or every couple of days, it will actually just burn out, whereas hard drives, they last a bit longer. But that doesn't mean that you should worry, because SSDs have, let's say, 100,000 read and write cycles. That's years and years and years of storage or of use of an SSD. It is very fast compared to a hard drive. Typically, even the very cheap SSDs go between 5 and 10 times faster than a traditional hard drive. This is why it is more than likely the logical assumption to make to say, if someone wants to do an upgrade on their laptop or desktop, going to an SSD makes a lot of sense, because straight away it will make the PC or the read and write speeds roughly 5 to 10 times faster. Next, extremely reliable because there are no moving parts. Now, when you have moving parts, like in an engine, so this is where it comes in. Because the hard drive has this spinning disk, it's constantly moving back and forth, back and forth. If you drop this, or if something happens where it is magnetized in some way, where it shifts the seek head 1 millimeter out, then you're going to have issues reading and writing your data. Because SSDs have no moving parts, it's simply a solid memory module, let's say. it is very efficient. It's very reliable. You drop this, if it doesn't crack or break, you're still fine. Whereas a hard drive, if you drop it and this shifts ever so slightly, then you might lose everything on the drive. Next, we have higher costs on hard drives. As I mentioned before, it is more expensive per gigabyte. Saying it is more expensive, in my opinion, is not enough, simply because I can spend £50 and I can get an SSD. I can also spend £50 and get a hard drive. However, the amount of storage I get in each one is going to be different. So if I want a 1 terabyte, well, here we have a 2 terabyte hard drive, that's $46.99, right? And if I go onto here, if I have, let's say, a 1 terabyte SSD is £100. So straight away, you can look and see that per gigabyte, SSDs are more expensive. They usually have lower storage capacity as well, as I've mentioned, but this is not something that's really common now, because you can get hard drives up to 8 terabytes. You can get SSDs up to and beyond 8 terabytes in some cases, but again, very, very expensive. We have optical disks, and optical coming from the word light, meaning that an actual laser inside the PC, inside your laptop, your disk drive, your DVD drive, your Blu-ray drive, uses a laser, as you can see here, this is the drive, to actually read and write, okay? It uses pits and LANs to actually present the information as binary, okay? But we're not going to focus too much on that. We're going to just look at the three types. We have CDs, DVDs, and Blu-rays. Now, a CD is typically, oh, here we have a nice one, actually. Yeah, here we go, perfect. CDs are typically 700 megabytes in size. Now, a dual layer CD, meaning that it has two layers, not back and front, but one layer at the top and one layer underneath, has twice as much. So 1,400 megabytes, okay? DVDs tend to have 4.7 gigabytes. And we also have dual layer DVDs, which have roughly 9.4 gigabytes as well. Finally, this is one that we're all probably familiar with, Xbox Ones, PlayStations, systems at home for watching movies, normally Blu-ray. 25 gigabytes. And again, if it's dual layer, it's going to be 50 gigabytes. So these are the three main types that we have. Now, there were CDs before the 700 megabyte one. Now, I think there were roughly 300 megabytes, but we don't need to focus on that too much. So the characteristics of optical discs, they're small and portable. Now, in most cases, you can fit this in your pocket, in a backpack, in a single book, and move around with it very, very easily. Back in my day, this is what we had to use for music, for movies, videos, pictures, everything. Even though they're easy to move around, they are very fragile. This under section here that does not have the label, it's very easy to damage. If I put this in my pocket with some coins and, I don't know, a pen, at the end of the day, this is more than likely going to be scratched. And because it is scratched, it's going to be damaged. And the data on there is going to be unusable in most cases. The read and write speed of CDs, DVDs, Blu-rays, it's not the best. It's not the best because it has such low read and write speeds. Many people actually don't use it anymore. Now, it is being used by the game companies, Microsoft, Sony, and others, to actually put games on there because it is such high capacity. You can put up to 50 gigabytes on a single disc, send it to your customer, they can install what they need to install, and that's it. But for an IT person, this is the very last option that we will ever use because it's so slow, because it's so fragile. Even though portable, it would make a lot more sense to use something like a USB memory stick or a memory card instead, or even a portable hard drive. That might make a lot more sense. It is compatible with a lot of devices, meaning so many devices around the world now. Your laptop probably has a CD drive, your Xbox, your PlayStation, your desktop at home, your DVD player, and they can all more or less access the information in a similar way. If I put images on my CD and put it in any one of those devices, it will most likely work. So it is the compatibility of CDs, very good. They are being phased out now because, again, though compatible, though they are portable, they are very fragile, and 700 megabytes, even 25 gigabytes, is not that much anymore. I can get a USB stick, 256 gigabytes worth of storage for about £20, and I can store as much stuff as that can hold, and it will fit. It's roughly the size of a finger, right? And I can fit that in anything. So here we have SD cards, very similar technology to that of the SSDs. It uses flash storage as well. However, this is much smaller and in most cases, much, much slower as well. A micro SD card, which is the one that you can see here, is roughly the size of a fingernail. Now, if you think about that, a fingernail can hold up to, in some cases, 1 terabyte, so 1,000 gigabytes. Now, the one here is only 256 gigabytes, but they do, here's one that's 512 gigabytes. So you can essentially store every single thing on your laptop. In most cases, some laptops come with 256 or 512 or even 1,000. You can store every single thing on a laptop on something the size of a fingernail. So that's the benefit of it. Very small, very portable, very reliable. It's also very compatible. Most Android phones nowadays have a memory card slot. Most smart TVs have a memory card slot. Most laptops have a memory card slot. Most cameras, most DVD players, most tiny Android boxes as well, they'll have a memory card slot somewhere, so you can actually bring this anywhere with you, stick it in a PC or any one of those devices, and have access to all your files. There are compatibility issues at times. If you don't have a very or an up-to-date phone, you might have issues. Whereas this one says micro SDXC, and you have others that will say different things. If you don't have the most up-to-date phone, this won't work in your phone, for example. You have to buy a phone that is actually compatible with this. Even though they're all exactly the same shape, the same size, the speeds will differ from the micro SDXC to something else, or micro SD SDHC, slightly different speeds, slightly different technology. So that's one issue that comes up there. Compatibility is a concern, but not so much nowadays, where most people in the first world change their phones every year, every 2 or 3 years. Now, I did read in the book that it generally has low capacity, so it says it's 64 gigabytes roughly, but as you can clearly see here, it goes up to, here we go, here's a 1 terabyte micro SD card, right? Again, very expensive. Remember, a 1 terabyte hard drive, I think it came in at roughly £50. So this is 4 times as much money for exactly the same amount of storage. But again, this is the size of a fingernail. So the benefits and the limitations. So we have to look at them and decide which one would be best. So in the exam, I might as well drop this in. You might get asked which storage device would be most suitable for this specific person and their needs. Now, if someone has a laptop and maybe they're a student, right? Cost might be an issue for them. So telling someone to go SSD or micro SD might not be the best thing. They might want to go for something that's relatively slower, but they can store more things. If someone is, I don't know, a PC gamer or someone who works in a music recording studio, they might want to go SSD, because speed and efficiency is the most important thing to them. And money, even though it might be important, speed and efficiency will always trump those two things. Next, we have USB memory sticks, probably the most common device that we all bring around as portable devices. So, characteristics, again, it uses similar technology to SSDs and to SD cards. It uses flash storage, albeit a lot slower in most cases than an SSD, and in some cases slower than SD cards as well. Extremely portable. I don't think I need to explain that. This is roughly, again, the size of a finger, whereas the SD card was roughly the size of a fingernail. So even though it's larger than the SD card, it's still significantly smaller than almost everything else. It only has, again, a finite number of read and writes because it is flash storage. So that's one of the characteristics of flash storage in general. Anything that has flash storage, you can only read and write to it a certain number of times. And read and write, read is simply maybe opening a file. Write is saving or creating a file. That's all that that means, okay? It's compatible with most devices, most computers, most TVs, most laptops, most consoles, even phones. My Android phone, I can actually get an adapter, plug a USB memory stick into it, and access my files from there. And it doesn't matter the size. Once it can power it, I can access my files from my Android phone, my Android tablet, my Android TV, my Xbox, my PlayStation, my laptop, my desktop, anything at all. Once it has a USB port, it's compatible. Now, a downside is that they can be lost easily. And because they are so portable, you use them on a computer, you pull them out, people do lose them a lot. However, it comes with the territory. Now, SD cards are more or less the same. But because SD cards are normally embedded in a device, so you plug it into your phone and you leave it there, it doesn't get lost as easily. But that's one of the downsides there as well. storage capacity is not as large as, let's say, hard drives and SSD. So this, again, is very similar to an SD card. This might go up to, I don't know, a terabyte or two as well. Whereas a hard drive, you can get 16, 18, 24 terabytes of storage on a hard drive and similar storage on an SSD as well. However, because this is portable, it is not meant to have so much storage, even though you can implement technology that has massive amounts of storage. Lastly, we have the magnetic tape drive. Not something that you would have seen anywhere probably other than the old style movie tapes or the old style music tapes, not used very much now, but you can use this technology for saving data. It requires specialist equipment, so it's not as easy to use as a USB memory stick or an SD card, a hard drive, because this has to have specialized equipment attached to the PC that's very, in some cases, could be quite expensive for it to work. So not very practical. Now, it uses a form of transmission called serial transmission. So we have serial and we have parallel. And if you know what parallel means, serial is simply the opposite. Parallel means we have two things going in the same direction, or two things, okay? If you do parallel, means there's two. Serial means one. So if we have data being transferred in one single direction at a time, it's going to be very slow compared to compared to parallel. Okay, so that's one of the downsides there. It's very slow. Is cheap per gigabyte because it is very, 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 very old technology. This was around, I'm going to say, from the 1970s onwards or 60s onwards. So because it's such old technology, it's very cheap. We've almost perfected it in some cases. Very large storage capacity as well. So we can have magnetic tapes that go up to however many gigabytes we want. We simply make the reel as large as we want, and we have as much storage as we need. Not used extensively now, but a use case could be, let's say, a school or a college wants to back up their data, right? It might be very inexpensive to do this method, though you might have to buy specialized hardware. They might do the backups every night at 11 p.m. when there's guaranteed to be no one at school. And every day, if they back up 4 or 5 gigabytes, even if it does take 6 hours, that's perfectly fine because there's going to be no one there for the next 10 hours. So though not used much now, that could potentially be a use case for it.